Now we are into lecture number 19. Okay, in today's class, we shall discuss about Miller's theorem and multistage amplifiers. So, the statement that what we had discussed yesterday, the Miller's theorem establishes that in a linear circuit, if there exists a branch with impedance Z connecting two nodes with the nodal voltages and V1 and V2, we can replace this branch by two branches connecting the corresponding nodes. Fine. So this is the statement. In simple words, I consider an electronic circuit. Okay, this is the electronic circuit. Fine. Now, how do I interpret this definition from the textbook? Fine. Many a times the figures are not given in the textbook, so you have to visualize the concept. Now, how do I visualize this theoretical concept? Okay. What it says is that we consider a circuit, okay, linear circuit, and there exists a branch with impedance Z, fine, connecting the two nodes. Now let us mark these nodes with the nodal voltages V1 and V2. So here it is. So we are having two nodes, node 1 and node 2. Node meaning a circuit point. Okay, a connection in simple words. And this node here, connection, is having a voltage V1 and here a voltage V2. Now, when we measure any voltage, it has to be, with some particular reference. In this case, we are measuring the voltage with respect to ground. Okay, and we name it as N node. Okay, so we can have n number of nodes. So right now we are just considering two active nodes, V1 and V2. Fine. And we are going to measure their voltages with respect to ground. Fine. Now what it says, the next statement, there exists a branch with impedance Z between the two nodes. So here, there exists a resistor in simple words. Fine. And let us specify it as Z. Now, we can replace this branch by two branches. So here right now we're having a single set of resistor. Fine. Now, as we have discussed yesterday, what are the typical cases? Like for example, I'm having a biasing circuit. Okay. In which I'm going to use collector to base bias. Okay. See, this is the fixed bias circuit. Okay. Here, this is the fixed bias circuit. RB, RC, and so on. This has got certain, limitations. So what we do is we opt for collector to base bias. Bias meaning a voltage. So there exists a voltage between collector and base. So here is the collector terminal and this is the base terminal. Now this, I'm not going to theoretical aspect of it. Why are we connecting this resistor and all? Because you people have studied this in the lower semester, okay, semester one. Now, for our point of understanding, we can treat this as two nodes, okay, V1 and this as V2, okay? And there exists a resistance with a notation Z. Now you see here, I have drawn this diagram. Now, can you visualize it now? What is V1, what is V2, and what is Z? So we are not bothered about the circuitry here inside. But what we are interested is just locating the nodes. And what we say here, there exists one impedance. Now, what is the issue with this resistor over here? The issue is, if I want to draw the equivalent circuit, okay? Now, equivalent circuit of transistor, I'm going for hybrid one, okay? Using the H parameter model, and that too, I'm using approximate modeling. So for transistor, it will be replaced by HIE and a constant current source, HFE IB. where IB is the input current which is going into the transistor, fine, positive IB. Now this is what I've drawn is simply a transistor equivalent, okay? But you see here there's one resistor RB and there's another resistor RC. Now when we draw the AC equivalent circuit, you know what are the steps. The steps are all the DC voltages should be connected to ground, shorted to ground, and all the capacitors have to be shorted. Now, in this case, I'm not using any capacitors. So only thing you need to concentrate is where is this DC voltage? Here, VCC. Fine. So both these points needs to be grounded. Okay. Now, where is RB connected? The one, see, always resistor has got two terminals, two ends. One end is connected to the base of the transistor and the second end is connected to the ground here. So this is base, this is emitter here, and this point is collector. So we have identified, those who have missed out the lecture, you can refer the lecture number 16, the guidelines, okay, how we draw. So RB, one end of the resistor is connected to the base, the second end goes to the ground, that is the common terminal here. This is RB, and this RB, okay, one end is connected to the collector, so I can start from here. The other end is connected to the ground, so I can have, you know, two circuits here. This is the input part of the circuitry, this is the output part of the circuitry. So input, I can apply input KVL here, output KVL for these two sections. Now if I concentrate on this particular circuit or the network, see, again, a transistor, notation is Q, has to be replaced by its equivalent hybrid model. Okay, this is what HIE, and this is HFE into IB. IB is the current passing through this resistor. So this completes my just the modeling of the transistor. Now you see here, we'll mark base, collector, and emitter. Fine. There exists a resistor from collector to VCC, and VCC has to be grounded. So I can simply connect the resistor here. So this resistor is represented here. Fine. Now, what about this Z? Z is connected between the base and the collector. So I have to take a resistor and connect here, Z. Now this, you know, complicates our analysis because we have to consider this Z as a part of input circuit as well as output circuit, and analysis becomes complicated. So here comes the Miller theorem. What it does is it decomposes this value of resistance into two parts. One part exclusively for input section, another part for the output section. So there is no such kind of bridge between the input and the output part. Okay, this is what is has been proposed by a Miller. So this point is clear. So we are just into 4-5 lines of it. And then what it says is that we can separate this resistor Z into two resistors with values Z divided by 1 minus K and K into Z divided by K minus 1, where K is V2 by V1. V2 is the voltage at this point, V1 over here. Now, the objective of today's class is to derive these values. Okay, the very simple derivation. So the Miller's theorem may be proved by using the equivalent two-port network to replace the two-port network by its equivalent and by applying the source absorption theorem. Okay, now this is just for your information. Next, let us try to understand the concept now. Fine. So what we had started is one circuit. There are two nodes, node 1 and node 2, having voltages V1 and V2 respectively. And there exists this resistor between the two nodes denoted as Z, and I'm having a ground connection. So V1 is measured with respect to this particular node. Fine. Now, what is being done here is that this circuit is represented in this fashion. So I'm having the same electronic circuit with two nodes, node 1, node 2, V1 and V2. Earlier there was a resistor here between the two nodes, and which was making our, you know, analysis complicated. Now what it says is, if we have separated these resistors into two parts, Z1 and Z2. Okay, now you can make out this is Z1 and Z2. That means their values are different. I'm not denoting this as Z and Z. If I denote it as Z and Z, that means their values are same. Fine. Now, here, if I want to check out the current I1, and here current passing through is I2. Current always flow from higher potential to lower potential. Fine. So I can write I1 equals to V1 by 0. Now, when I try to find the current between the resistor, first you locate the two ends of the resistor, then you see which is the higher potential and which is the lower potential. So current will always flow from higher potential to lower potential. Current is I, this is a V dash, and this is V dash dash. So R. So if I want to calculate I, it will be V dash, the change, the difference in the potential divided by resistance. This is the formula. So whenever you come across any circuit, however complex it may be, the fundamental, the work of the resistor is going to remain the same. It will limit the current and it will offer the resistance. Fine. A voltage will get drop across it. These are the just two application of any resistor. Fine. Now, let us check out what is the current I1. It flows from V1 to this point. Now, this point is already connected to ground. So the voltage at this point will be zero. So that is represented here. So I can simply write I1 as V1 by Z1. Okay. And similarly, the current I2 flows from V2 to zero and divided by Z2. So it is V2 by Z2. Clear? Now, if I look at this particular circuit, say, let us mark this as current I1 and this as current I2. Now, for this particular circuit, I1 can be written as V1 minus V2 by Z. Now, this I1 equals to, now I'm dividing throughout by V1. So what I get is 1 minus V2 by V1 Z by V1. Okay. And now let us define a parameter K, which is equal to V2 by V1. Okay. Ratio of two voltages. V2 by V1, let us mark it as K. So the current, another I1 equals to 1 minus of K divided by ZV1. Okay. And we have I1 equals to V1 by Z1. I1 equals to V1 by Z1, and I1 is also 1 minus K Z by V1. So I can equate this and I can write Z1 equals to Z by 1 minus of K. This is the first expression. Fine. So the value of Z1 here is equal to Z upon 1 minus K, Well, Z is the actual impedance value, a resistance value. K is the ratio of two voltages at two nodes, V2 by V1. Okay. Similarly, Z2 calculation, I2 is V2 by Z2. From here, I2 is V2 by Z2. And I2 can also be written as V2 minus of V1 by Z for this particular figure. So this is figure 1 and here this is figure 2. So I have listed for figure 1 and figure 1 and figure 2. Now again let us divide this throughout by V1. So it is V2 by V1 minus of 1 Z by V1. So what I get is V2 by V1 is K minus of 1 and this is Z by V1. Okay. And this is what current I2. So we have also defined I2 as V2 by Z2. So V2 by Z2 equals to K minus of 1 Z by V1. So further simplifying this expression, what I get is Z2 equals to K into Z and Z minus of 1. So this is Z2 and we have already obtained the value of Z1 as Z by 1 minus of K. So if I'm having a circuit using the transistor and there's a resistor here Z, then I can split this Z into two parts. Okay. One is Z1 and second one is Z2. Okay. Using this set of expression. So that completes our Miller's theorem. So we had seen the application. Why it is important? Because whenever we come across a circuit like this, then same value will be reflected in your equivalent circuit. And whenever we have common element between the input and output, the analysis becomes tedious and complex. So to simplify this, we make use of Miller theorem. Normally a short note is asked on Miller theorem. Discuss the Miller theorem or explain the significance of Miller theorem as far as AC equivalence is concerned. The performance of this single stage amplifier we have already discussed. Now there is something called as gain. When I apply a signal here, okay, this signal, let me complete the circuit, ground RL, so output is obtained across the load resistor. Fine. So here signal will be amplified in the opposite direction. Now if I check out the strength, the magnitude, the amplitude of this, and if I compare with this input signal, that ratio will give me the gain of the circuit. Fine. Now the gain of the circuit, if you have paid the attention, the voltage gain is minus of RC by RE. Okay. RC is the collector resistor and RE is the dynamic emitter resistance. Fine. This we have solved yesterday using the RE model. Okay. So you see from this statement, from this expression, we can say that the gain of the amplifier, it depends on the parameters of the device. Okay. And the circuit component. Parameter of the device is this RE and this is the circuit component. Okay. But theoretically, there exists an upper limit for the gain that can be obtained. For example, if simplest case, okay, I'm having an input of 2 millivolts, okay, and I say I'm having an amplifier of gain 10, and then I'm going to get the output of 20 millivolts. Okay. Now, slightly complicated. 1 volt applied to a circuit having a voltage gain of 20. What we expect here? Output to be 20 volts. But practically speaking, the output of your amplifier circuit cannot exceed VCC. Fine. For this, you have to recollect the DC load line. Maximum value can be VCC and this is IC. So output cannot exceed VCC. If I'm using VCC of 12 volt, is it possible to get output of 20 volt? No. Fine. So there exists some limit. But what when I go for a multi-stage amplifier, the noise is also under control. Now this voltage amplification or the power gain or the frequency response, okay, that we obtain using a single stage amplifier is not sufficient. Now for the first time you are coming across this word frequency response. Now frequency response is nothing but it is a plot of gain in dB, voltage gain in dB. How do I calculate in terms of dB? It is 20 log of output by VI. So this is AV in terms of dB. Otherwise, the voltage gain is V0 by VI. Now, why are we following this logarithmic response? Why this log is used here? Again, slightly we'll go into detailing of it. Now, most of the time we use these amplifiers for amplification of the speech signal, the sound signal, the audio signal. Okay. Now, if the intensity of say sound is say 1 unit, okay, and then I increase the intensity of sound to say 10 units. Now, what will be the response of our ear? At 1 unit, okay, it is listening at that same value, okay? But when I increases to 10 units, okay, the ear response will not be 10 times the original response. It is in terms of logarithmic scale. So our response, the ear response is given in terms of logarithmic scale, okay? That's the reason why we make use of a logarithmic, okay, in case of a voltage amplifier. Now in case of frequency response, what we do is we plot on the y-axis we are having gain, voltage gain in dB, and on x-axis we are having frequency terms, okay? So what is the job of the amplifier? The job of the amplifier is to amplify all the signals, okay, equally. Meaning if the frequency is 1 kilohertz, let me draw it. Response meaning this is the response now, okay? It varies from say 10 hertz or to 20 kilohertz. So our pitch, our voice frequency has a range from 10 hertz to 20 kilohertz. So when we design any amplifier, this amplifier should amplify all the frequencies with the same ratio, okay, with the same gain. In fact, I hope this is clear. So our response has to be straight enough. Now, for example, if you are having an amplifier, a single stage amplifier with a frequency response of this type, okay, here this is a 10 hertz, here this is 10 kilohertz, and here this point is say 20 kilohertz. Now check out the difference between the two. For lower frequencies, okay, the signal is not amplified to the earlier expected value. Again, up to 10 kilohertz it is amplifying, but over and about 10 kilohertz the signal is getting degraded. Fine. So in this case, we say that the amplifier has not been designed properly. Clear? Now this stage has a gain of say 10. This stage has gain 100. This stage has gain has a gain of say 1000. Now if I want to calculate the gain, okay, what I need to do is I just multiply 10 into 100 into 10,000. Sorry, 1000. But if I take it into a transform into a log, then I just need to add the gains. Okay, so multiplication becomes your plus addition. Okay, secondly, for example, if it permits us, you know, to denote a very small as well as a very large quantity, like for example, 10 hertz and 20 kilohertz. Can you imagine a 10 hertz and the higher end is 20 kilohertz? If I take a simple graph sheet which has got 12 by 18, you know, squares of 1 centimeter, is it possible for us to plot 10 hertz to 20 kilohertz? It's not possible because the range is very, very high, 10 hertz to 20 kilohertz. So for that reason, we make use of something called as semi-log paper, which you'll be using when you perform the practicals. Just like we have a graph paper, we have a semi-log paper to plot this a very big range. For example, okay, if the gain is say 0.000, this is another way to understand. Okay, then this is actually a loss in the signal. Okay, so this will be represented as minus 120 dB, or a loss of voltage loss of 120 dB. Similarly, a power gain of a value 456,000 will be equal to 56.6 dB. Now you have realized the significance of this. If I were to plot this range from 0.00001 to 456,000, then just imagine what should be the scale. Okay, but if I go into the, you know, decibels, then I can represent that entire big range on a conveniently a smaller sheet. Fine. This is one reason. Second reason, what I was talking about, the hear response, the output of the amplifiers. Okay, it is ultimately converted into a sound, isn't it? And this sound is recepted or received by the human ear. Now experiment shows us that like the ear response to the sound intensities on a proportional or a logarithmic scale rather than linear scale. This is what I was trying to explain you all. For example, if the audio power increases from say, like here only, 4 watts to or watts to 64 watts. Fine. This is the, I'm listening to a sound, a speech, and which has been increased from 4 watts to 64 watts. Okay. Now, our hearing level will not 16. So, try to understand this setup. I was listening to a sound of 4 watts, and then somebody increases it to a volume of, say, 64 watts. Okay. Now, the hearing level does not increase by a factor of 16. It is not linear, but it will, you know, just increase by a factor of only 3. And why 3? Because 4 is to 3 is 64, isn't it? So this is the logarithmic scale or a proportional scale. I hope this is clear. Fine. I gave you the 2 points. One is we need to plot this particular range, a big range, on a semi-log paper. So that time it's very handy if you make use of a, you know, logarithmic scale, and also from the, you know, practical point of view, you know, day-to-day point of view, if the sound is increased from 4 watts to 64 watts, then our, you know, ear response will not be 16 times more, but it will be just 3 times more. Why? Because our response is not linear. Okay. Another example, why are we going into this DB. Say for example, there are three stages, and here what I've drawn, each stage, I'll explain to this figure later on. Now, this I'm explaining from the decibel point of view. Say for example, there are three stages. Now, what we mean by stage? So basically, it's a collection of amplifiers. And why are we studying this multi-stages? Is we simply cannot take the output from here using a wire and cannot connect it to the next stage. This is not practically possible. Fine. Similarly, I cannot take the output of this stage and connect as an input to the next stage. Practically, it is not possible. Fine. Because there is something called as loading that will we discuss in detail. Okay. This is not possible. So there is some mechanism, okay, by which we can join the two stages. Okay. Whenever we have more than one stage, it is referred to as multi-stage. Right now, what I've drawn here is a three-stage amplifier. There are three stages. Okay. Why are we going for this stages? Why can't we use the single amplifier? I've listed it out. The output is limited theoretically by your VCC value. So we can have multiple stages to increase the booster gain. Now, for example, the voltage gains of these three stages are say 30, 50 and 80. This has got nothing to do with 30 plus 50. Okay. Individual gain is 80, individual gain is 50 and so on. This is gain in terms of dB. So I'll write A1 dB, A2 dB and A3 dB. Fine. So if I want to calculate the gain, then A1 dB, A dB1 will be equal to 20 log to the base 10, value is 30. So if you solve this, you get the answer is 29.54 dB. So in terms of dB, it will be 29.54. This is the voltage gain, normal voltage gain. Okay. And this is the gain in dB. Similarly, for the second case, in terms of dB, 20 log of 50. The answer is 33.98 dB. So voltage gain is 50 and in terms of dB, it is 33.98. Let me write here on top. This is the voltage gain. 30, 50 and 80. Okay. These are the simplest voltage gain. What is voltage gain? V naught by VI. So for example, what is this 50? 50 is nothing but V2 by V1 is 50. V1 by V in is 30 and so on. Okay. And V naught by V2 is 80. So this is the voltage gain. Now, I'm trying to calculate it in terms of dB. Similarly, gain of third stage is 20 log of 80 to the base 10. This is understood. So this is 38.06 dB. Fine. Now, what is the advantage in representing it in our dB form? I just simply need to add this up. So total gain in terms of dB will be 29.54 plus 33.98 plus 38.06. So the total value is 101.58 dB. Okay. Now, alternatively, okay, the different way, the other approach is we could have, determined this gain otherwise as 30 into 50 into 80. Okay. If I do so, I get the answer as 120. And then I can calculate the overall gain as 20 log of our value is, I'm going to get the same answer. But when we express in terms of dB, we have to simply add this. Now, since I have taken this as a simple values, it seems so very easy. Fine. But otherwise, it's always advisable to express the gain in terms of dB. Now, the question the topic of our interest is how do we combine the two stages. Okay. Now this what I've drawn right now is the single stage amplifier with some typical, you know, values. It's a two port network. Now, as I said, like we simply cannot take a wire and connect between the output of this section and the input of the next section, which is, you know, practically has some limitation or it will result in some kind of losses. So there are actually four ways to join, okay, these two blocks, and this joining is called as coupling. Fine. So joining one amplifier stage with the other stage in cascade. So one more new term. Cascade meaning in series. Okay. So when I have, you know, multiple stages and if I want to join them, then this entire circuit is then referred to as multi-stage amplifier circuit. Fine. Now there are four basic methods of coupling. So four basic methods are, the first one is four basic methods of coupling. Coupling meaning just joining. Joining of what? Two stages of what? Multi-stage amplifier. Clear? Now four basic methods are, the first one is resistance, capacitance, coupling. It's a very easy topic. The second one is impedance coupling, which is not listed in our syllabus, so we'll not touch upon this part. Third part is transformer coupling, and the fourth one is direct coupling. There are certain instances wherein this direct coupling is used and is very much required. So from syllabus point of view, direct coupling, not impedance coupling. Now this capacitor Cin, if it is not present, the signal source will be in parallel to the resistance R2, and the bias voltage of the transistor will be changed. I hope this point is clear. If I don't connect this capacitor here, fine. If there is some DC component, that DC component will appear in parallel with this resistor. And what is the job of this R1, R2 is to have some value of V here. Okay. Using a voltage divider rule, I can easily calculate V here. What is the value of V? It will be R2 upon R1 plus R2 into VCC. You know the value of VCC, 12 volts, R1 is 22K, R2 is 6.8K. So if you substitute these values, you're going to get one value of voltage here. Fine. This is theoretical. I don't have to connect the circuit. And practically, when you mount this circuit on a breadboard, and if you apply signal, you can check out what is the voltage here. Or there are simulators available. You can simulate the circuit. You can check out the voltage. So theoretical value and practical value should match. In theoretical values, we'll come across the components. In the practical values, we are not interested in the formulation. We just take a multimeter and check that value. Okay. Now, what if I don't connect a capacitor? Then this input signal, a DC component of it, will interfere with this voltage. And we have decided, like right in the beginning, this what should be the value of this voltage. This voltage should not change. If it changes, your entire biasing will be affected. And the moment the biasing is affected, your output current and your output voltage will be changed. And that is the last thing what you expect when you design the circuit. Fine, because you start with the concept that output voltage should be so and so, output current should be so and so. Because of this, some silly reasons, your entire circuitry will falter. Okay, so here what this Cin does, it allows the AC signal from the source to flow into input circuit without affecting the bias. Let me come to this emitter bypass capacitor. It is denoted as C2, or some of the textbook will denote this as CE. Okay, we don't have 50 microfarad. The nearest value is 47 microfarad. We don't have 20, it is 22 microfarad practical value. Okay, now this emitter bypass capacitor CE is connected in parallel to the emitter resistor, and what it does, it offers a very low reactance part to the amplified signal. If I don't connect this capacitor, what will happen? If I don't connect this capacitor, the AC signal which is developed here, last signal, the same signal will, you know, available here, the same current will pass through this resistor, and there will be some voltage getting drop across this resistor. And if I follow this loop, this is the incoming signal and this is the signal which is at the resistor. So this signal is going to interfere with the input signal and your gain will be reduced. Fine. So there exists some feedback. So we have to avoid this feeding back of the signal. So what we do, we provide a separate path for this AC signal, okay, to go to the ground. We don't want any AC signal to get drop across these resistors. The job of this R1, R2 and R4 or RE is to maintain the Q point, that is the DC operating point, fixed. Fine, it is required for DC operation point of view, not AC. So if you're following these lectures, last 2-3 lectures, you might have realized when we draw the AC equivalent circuit, this is not a part of your hybrid equivalent model or RE equivalent model. Those who are, you know, paying attention, they will follow this topic. Fine. Next, we have the coupling capacitor. Why this coupling capacitor is required? See, if I don't connect the coupling capacitor, I have shown this diagram here. I have not connected any coupling capacitor. I'm directly taking the output. So I'm going to have DC voltage as well as AC voltage. DC voltage will be how much? VCC. There'll be some voltage getting dropped across this, like this RC. There'll be some voltage getting dropped across this RC. How much is the voltage? That voltage given as IC into RC. Okay. If I'm applying, say, 12 volt, then say 6 volt is getting dropped here. So what will be the share here? Remaining 6 volt, there'll be 1 or 2 volt getting dropped here. So let us say 2 volts is getting dropped here. 6 volts is, you know, simply getting dropped across this resistor. Remaining 8 minus 12, 4. 4 volts will be available at the output. You can see this line. This line represents a DC voltage, which is say 4 volts. Okay. Now, typically what we're interested is in a pure AC signal. We don't want any DC component of it. So what we do is we connect this capacitor. Fine. The moment I connect the capacitor, what is the job of this capacitor? The job of this capacitor is to block the DC voltages. And why is going to block the DC voltage? Because the reactance offered by capacitor is 1/2πfC. And for DC frequency is 0. If I substitute here, I'm going to get 1/0 as infinity. Fine. So for DC, capacitor will block. If I'm having capacitor and if I pass a DC signal, it will block the DC and AC will easily flow. Why? Higher the frequency, less will be the reactance. Fine. So if I connect a capacitor, the same output will be this way. Amplitude is going to remain the same. Just like here, whatever amplitude I get will be the same. But now what I have done, reference value was 0 here. So your signal was lying on that 4 volts DC, which is of no use. So the moment I connect a capacitor, the reference level will shift to 0. And this will be say +3 and -3. Otherwise it was 0 and say 6 volt. Fine. This is not as per the scale, but still, I hope the point is clear to all. And why are we interested in the AC signal only? Because finally, in case of amplifier, what is the end stage? The end stage is always it is a speaker, and speaker is run by your AC signal. Fine. So this point is clear. And this speaker, it represents, it, no, actually a heavy load in the audio amplifier system. So several amplifier stages are required. So you might have heard of preamplifiers, then power amplifiers, output amplifiers. Now these are actually a part of, you know, large stages of amplification. Okay. Now we were discussing about these four basic methods of coupling. Okay. And what is the job of coupling? Is to join the two stages. Fine. Now there are certain, you know, things what we expect from this coupling. Output is taken from here. I can have same VCC. I don't require any separate, you know, batteries for that. I can tap from the same VCC. Now, how do I join these two wires? This is the output of the first stage, and this is the input of the second stage. Okay, I need to join this. So one way is I take a capacitor and join this. This is connected to ground. Ground is common, and output is obtained here. So this is what is referred to as RC coupling. Why it is called as RC? Because here this resistor and this capacitor helps us to join the two stages of amplification, two stages of amplifiers followed. So this is what is referred to as RC coupling. In case of direct coupling, I will simply connect. Now look here, if this is the input, fine, output at this stage will be amplified in the opposite direction. This is what we refer as 180 degree phase shift. Now this amplified signal becomes input to the second stage. Again, it will be amplified in the opposite direction. So can you make out the difference now? Another 180 phase shift is provided by common emitter. Only common emitter provides 180 degree phase shift, no other configuration. So you see then the signals are in phase. For positive, we're having amplification in the positive direction. So total phase shift is for two stage is 180 plus 180. Fine. Now the point of what I was trying to stress here is how do I couple? So it is coupled using two component R and C. So it is referred to as RC. We'll study it in detail, but then what should be the, you know, criteria for this coupling networks? First and the foremost is it should not disturb the DC bias condition. See, it is not just the voltage here. So when it is a speech signal, you know, frequencies are keeps on changing. So your frequency should not be disturbed. So it should pass on all the frequencies, all the incoming frequencies should be passed on. I hope this point is clear. The third point, what we were discussing about the voltages and currents. Fine, that's one thing. The second part is most of the time these amplifiers are used for amplification of your sound signal, speech signal, voice signal, audio signal. Your frequency should not be disturbed by these coupling elements. Okay, so the coupling, in other words, the coupling network should offer equal impedance to various frequencies of signal. Now when I say audio signal, our, you know, frequency ranges from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. Actually it's up to 15 kilohertz. You know, in the orchestra we have this high frequency range from 15 to 20 kilohertz. Above 20 kilohertz, our ears cannot respond to it. We cannot hear. So it's from 20 hertz to 15 kilohertz. But whenever we design the amplifier, this amplifier should amplify all the frequencies with the same amount. It's not that 1 kilohertz will be suppressed and 10 kilohertz will be enhanced. This type of thing should not be done. Okay, so the four basic methods of coupling are resistive coupling, then RC coupling, transformer coupling, resistive capacitive coupling, impedance coupling, transformer coupling, and direct coupling. So this is the coupling capacitor. It couples the output. Here this is the input. Output of the first stage is coupled to the input of the second stage. So here on it is second stage. Up to here, this is the first stage. You can see this is the input signal. It is amplified in the opposite direction. And when it undergoes another amplification stage, it will be further amplified in the opposite direction. So finally, it is in phase. So we call it as 360 degree phase shift. Fine. So just for 10-12 seconds, have a look at this circuit diagram. Then we'll discuss. It is a two-stage amplifier circuit, okay, and it has two transistors. Then it is connected in CE configuration, and it has a common power supply, VCC. Fine. See, once you know the circuit diagram properly, you can, describe it very easily. So as far as construction is concerned, it is a two-stage amplifier circuit connected in CE configuration and a common power supply VCC is used. What we mean by common? There are two circuits, first stage and second stage, and both the stages are driven by single source VCC. Fine. Then the potential divider network. Now, why I'm writing this? Because this part is common to all the three couplings: RC coupling, transformer coupling, and direct coupling. The input capacitor C in at the present at the input stage of the amplifier. What it does? It couples the input signal. This we had discussed earlier. This signal is coupled, meaning it is fed to the base of the transistor Q1. Fine. Now here is the figure. So whenever a construction is asked, this much is sufficient. Now what is the job of this CC? And who can cause this DC? Here, this VCC, what we have discussed. This VCC can, disturb your Q point. So this DC voltage has to be blocked. And who is going to do that for you? It is the blocking capacitor or this coupling capacitor. Fine. Now let us try to understand the operation. When this input signal is applied to the base, it will be amplified by the transistor. Fine. And it appears at the collector load, which is then passed through the coupling capacitor CC to the next stage. Now this becomes the input, whatever here, this becomes the input to the second stage or the next stage, which is again going to amplify it, and it appears across the load resistance. So the signal is amplified twice here, stage by stage. Now the important point that has to be noted here is that the total gain is less than the individual gain, product of individual gains, meaning if the gain is 2, say 5, and gain is 10, we expect the gain to be 50, but it is not the case. When we have a cascaded form, the gain is actually less than the product of the gains. This is the gain of individual stage. Gain 1, and this is gain 2. Okay. This is because when a second stage is made to follow the first stage, okay, the effective load resistance of the first stage is reduced due to the shunting effect. Because it comes in parallel, shunt means parallel. Shunting effect. Hence, in a multi-stage amplifier, only the gain of the last stage remains unchanged. Rest all the stages, the gain is disturbed. Fine. And another point to be noted here is that since we consider a two-stage amplifier here, the output phase is same as the input, meaning when the input is positive, in the positive half, at that instant, output is also positive. Fine. So because it has done the phase reversal twice, so this is one phase reversal, and this is another phase reversal. So this was about the operation of the circuit.